Hi, my name is Sebastian Völk, also known as Iron Skin. In this video, we will have a look at the sizes of chainmail rings and how they affect the properties of a whole mesh. Rings have an inner diameter, in short, ID. It determines how far a mesh of chainmail can stretch. Also, there is the wire diameter, WD. It is a key factor to tell about the strengths of chainmail. To make good chainmail, one has to balance a variety of properties. Many of those properties mean quite the opposite. On this graph, moving horizontally means to change the inner diameter. If we move vertically, we change the wire diameter. Rings of the same type and material can, for example, be made with big inner diameter, like this, but then they also have big gaps that could be penetrated. Or rings are made with small inner diameter. With small inner diameter, it takes more effort to make chainmail, but it's more difficult to penetrate. In a similar way, rings of same type and material are either made of thick wire, thus they are very strong and heavy, or they are made of thin wire. Consequently, they are rather fragile, but lightweight. Yet is there a limit? Yes, there is. You cannot make rings with small inner diameter and big wire. These rings will not have enough space to fit other rings in them. Even this ring barely has enough space because the other rings, drawn in white, actually need to sit at an angle. In the end, only a few choices remain possible. Strength has a lot to do with wire thickness. It is not the only parameter, but the most important. The effort for making chainmail is mainly determined by the inner diameter. When we talk about strengths of chainmail, we must also talk about weight at the same time. We want to compare sheets of chainmail that cover the same area, so we can judge how much protection we get for the weight that we have to carry. For the following simulations, let's compare pieces that are 10 centimeters times 10 centimeters, just like this piece. So, how many rings does this piece of chainmail contain? What do you think? Have a close look. You can guess the number or count every single ring. Pause the video if you like. So, the number of rings for this piece of chainmail is 218. It is not just 15 times 8. There are also rings between the rows, so another 7 times 14. This gives us 120 plus 98, makes a total of 218 rings. Which is quite a lot if you consider that's just 10 times 10 centimeters and it's not even a big piece of chainmail. Let's have a look. How does the inner diameter affect the number of rings needed for our sample sheet of 10 times 10 centimeters? I plotted this graph in octave. It's based on my calculations for riveted rings. You see the number of rings in vertical direction. The number of rings depends on the inner diameter on the left axis and the wire diameter on the right axis. Not all combinations are possible if we want to link four rings into one. So let's cross them out. You can see that 8 mm inner diameter is not that extreme. Though, moving towards smaller rings, the number increases dramatically. This means more effort to make chainmail. You can also see that the wire diameter doesn't change much. It only makes the chainmail fold slightly. Thus, more rings are needed to cover the same area. Thank you for holding on until this point. Now, let's have a look how the ring's inner diameter and wire diameter affect the weight of the sheet. You see the weight per area in vertical direction and the inner diameter on the left axis. The wire diameter is on the right axis. I didn't even plot all possibilities here, but again, we can cross out the rings that we cannot use for European 4-in-1 chainmail. We learned that we want to stay away from the tiny rings in the far left, where effort is high. We also do not want to be in the area of big, thin rings, because they will have significant gaps that someone could poke through. We want big wire diameters. It is a main factor for strength, but we can't go to extremes because it will make us carry a lot of weight. So we will use just the right wire diameter that is sufficient to protect us. Whatever that means depends on the battlefield or the situation the chainmail is used in. If the chainmail is not strong enough, an armorer can simply use stronger wire to make better chainmail. So we end up settling here in the middle. That is in some distance to the area that we crossed out. If we go close to that area, the mesh of chainmail becomes very rigid. But we want to be able to move without restriction. It turns out that there's a certain ratio of inner diameter to wire diameter, which is very practical. In my opinion, 1.2 mm wire is good for 8 mm rings. That is a ratio of 6.666. It's a personal choice. Let me know in the comments how you see this. Let's see what that means if you want to make chainmail yourself. There are only certain sizes of wire that you can buy. This graph is telling you which inner diameter and which wire diameters you can combine. In the European Union, there are wires in millimeter. They're shown in blue. All glory to the metric system! In the United States, wires are measured by the American wire gauge. In the middle, you see some reasonable combinations. Summing up, we can say small rings do not necessarily make better chainmail. Neither do big rings. It's all about balancing the four properties: strength, weight, gap size, and effort. Thank you for watching. I'm looking forward to your comments. If you want to see more about how to make riveted chainmail, check out my other video. If you like my videos, please subscribe and make sure to hit the bell icon, and you will actually get notified when I make new videos. Thank you so much. See you next time.